Ready.
Okay guys, so today I'm going to go over design of two-way slats. Two-way slats, the method that I will go over is the strip method for two-way slats. There are typically three methods. There is the direct design method, there is the equivalent frame method, and there is the strip method for two-way slats. Usually both of those methods, two-way slats, is covered in a second course in reinforced concrete design. Second course. But I covered this one so you have just some basic information about how you design two-way slab. As if you remember from structural analysis, how we say this is one-way or two-way slab, based on the long side to the short side ratio. If the long side divided by the short side is greater or equal to 2, that's one way. If it's less than 2, that's two-way slab. And we showed how the load is transferred from the slab to the beams. Before I go, there is one concept. I know we went over one-way slab, but there is one concept I need to clarify. What's the difference between a slab and plate?
Concrete and steel.
No, concrete slab and concrete plate. When do we say this slab is a plate? No? No clue? The first page. In the one-way slab design, I think he talks about all different types of slab. In the book, if you are following the book, you should. Anytime we explain something, you should go back and see if there's anything with the book. Laura, do you remember? Okay, if there are edge beams on the side of the slab, it's a slab. If there are no edge beams, it's called plate. There are only columns. No edge beams, that's a plate. With edge beams, that's a slab. I just saw this question in the FE exam, by the way. A slab without the following is considered a slab, a plate, or whatever. No edge beams is a plate. With edge beams is a slab. Okay? So there is different types. There is the one-way slab, there is two-way slab, there is the ripped slab, not used in the USA. Here we use solid slab. There is the PT slab, post-tension slab, or pre-stressed slab, the same concept. There is something called waffle slab. Okay, waffle slab. There are so many different types. That slab will be like sections, like T sections with the slab. There is one of the parking garages, if you go see it, there is like a double T section with a slab for that parking garage. So the waffle slab is something close to that. You see like squares coming from in the airports if they are made of reinforced concrete called waffle slab. Like the waffle. So there's different types. It's good to know them. So at least you know what you're talking about. But when you say one way or two way, we are talking about dimensions. Dimensions. And how is the load is carried by the slab? What strips of the slab? What side of the slab? What's that? The good thing about this method is its flexibility, especially sometimes when you have opening, is that you can assume a distribution of the load or a moment field to carry the total load. The given loading, if we assume the load on the slab is W, distributed load. Usually the load on the slab is specified by what? Per square foot, right? Per unit area, right? That's how I give you the load on the slab. Per unit area. Why we give it by per unit area? Why is not concentrated? One of the major assumptions at the beginning of the slab, remember, one of the major assumptions, we assume the load on the slab is uniformly distributed. And that assumption is valid because the slab is an element, structural element, has the ability of redistribution of stresses. Okay? All work as integral part. If one segment of the slab or one tiny small spot or area reach yielding, there will be no failure. Might be some cracking, but it will ask for help from the neighbors. Okay? From the neighbor strips. Okay? So it's an integral element. So that assumption for assuming uniformly distributed load on the slab is valid. Okay, so that's W. That W must be carried by something. Must be carried by something. By the cross-section we are providing and the steel. Remember, we're talking about flexural element. Slab is a flexural element. When I say flexural element, you should understand this concept. What flexural element mean? Flexural element, or I can say ductile element. Right? Those they experience plastic behavior before failure. They are ductile. Okay, they have ductility. they are safe when they fail. Not brittle element like a column. Okay? They experience plastic deformation before failure. So that load must be carried by something. Now, the only difference, the difference between a slab and a beam. Look, in a beam, we designed for flexure, right? Did we have one moment or two moments in the beam? One moment, right? One moment coming from the load. Okay? And that moment creates stress in the direction of the beam. That's why we have tension and we have compression in the direction of the beam. That tension came from where? From a stress in the steel. A stress in the steel times the area of the steel gave us the tension. Likewise, a stress in the concrete times the area of the concrete gave us compression. Both they created couple, internal couple, to resist the external couple from the applied load. But there was only moment. We did not see a moment in the other direction. If we look at the cross section, we did not see moment. That's the theory of a beam. Its length compared to its cross-sectional dimension is long, usually greater than 10 or 12. If the length and the width are almost the same or have small relationship, like a slab, right? We're saying the length, the long side, if it's even one way, it's two. It means there is, the section is rectangular cross-section. It means there is a moment in the x direction and there is a moment in the y direction. Right? So the strips in the x direction resist and the strip in the y direction resist. Now, let's go back. In one way slab, what did we say? We said the load is carried by the strips in the short direction. Because that slab will curve in that direction. Only curvature in the short direction. It will not curve in the long direction. No curvature, no moment. Because there is a relationship between the curvature and the moment. You should know it as any civil engineer, the curvature equal M over EI. Curvature equal M over EI. Is there a relationship between the curvature and the deflection? Is there a relationship between, let's go back to some mechanics. A relationship between curvature and deflection? Laura? Austin? Josh? You're still fresh from structures. Mathematically, I want mathematical or engineering. Yes, Glenn. No? What is it? So you have a chance to pass this course. Yeah, tell me, I'll give you 1 point. Okay, you guys, all of you should not go repeat structure. I swear, you go repeat strength of material. Okay, moment curvature relationship is the double integration theory. EI y double prime equal M. That y double prime is the curvature. What's y? It's the deflection. So the second derivative of the deflection is the curvature. The first derivative of the deflection is the slope. So the first derivative of the slope is the deflection, is the curvature. Integration of the slope is the deflection. EI y double prime equal M. Y double prime equal M over EI. I just told you. It means y double prime is phi, the curvature. So no curvature, no moment. Right? So EI times 0 equals 0 moment. So that's one way slab. No curvature in the long direction. It doesn't curve in the long direction. We assume the long direction stays straight. Only the short direction curve. Now when you have two way slab, the ratio is less than 2. They both curve. So it curve in both directions. It means there is a moment resistant in both directions. Curvature means resistant. How structure member resists the load? By deformation and creating internal forces to resist. That's how they behave, right? Right? How you gonna resist the load? This, how it's gonna resist the load? You apply a load, it will move. That's how it behaves, it will move, unless you restrain it. If you restrain, there are reaction and there are internal forces to resist any moment you apply, any shear force you apply, any other thing, right? But they deform under loading. Structures deform, structural members deform under loading. Now, there is a curvature in both directions, I said. So there is a moment in the x direction and a moment in the y direction, right? It's curving. I need your note. So it's curving in both directions, right? In both. In one way, it was like that. In two way, it's like that. So there is a moment in this direction and there is a moment in this direction, right? So look, look. Do you know what dv over dx equal? First derivative of shear over first derivative of dx, which is the length. dv over dx equal what? Okay. Where's the shear force come from when you draw the shear diagram? You have the loading, right? Right? Where's the shear gonna come from? From the area under the load distribution, right? Or whatever loading we have. So it's the integration of the loading. So the derivative of the shear is? The derivative of the shear is the load, W. So dV over dx equal W. Sometimes minus W if W is up positive or up down, depending on the book. But if it's positive, dV over dx equal W. Okay? Okay, now what's dm over dx? Is the shear. Yes. dm over dx equal shear. Right? Now, what's d square m over dx square? W. So the load is resisted with this flux element with the slab by second derivative of the moment with respect to x. And there is another one. So partial square m x over partial x squared plus partial square my over partial y squared equal the load, supposed to equal the load. Not only that, think about it. Now, there's one more term. If this guy wanna bend in this direction, this side wanna do this, but this side wanna do this. This wanna curve in this direction. But the other side wanna carry in this direction. We said for two ways now, right? What does it mean? It means this one is relieving some of the moment on this one, or the deflection resulting in the moment in this one. Or this side is trying to do what? To twist the other side. So there is a twisting resistance in each side with respect to the other side. So the resistance also from partial mxy over partial x partial y. In this theory, we're gonna ignore this twisting resistance to be conservative. So the twisting resistance is ignored. That's give you some factor of safety. So later on when we simplify things or assume something, we know that we have some margin of safety. Not only that, guys, in any, when you have reinforced concrete design, there is something called strain hardening of steel. You know what strain hardening? Did you do the tensile test in the lab? Okay, you had problem doing that, right? But how it looks like, the stress strain diagram of steel, you go elastic up to the proportional limit, then there is some small area here for the upper or lower and upper yielding, whatever, then it go up like that, right? That thing we call it strain hardening, right? And usually, believe it or not, the tensile strength with respect to Fy of the reinforcing bars is 1.25. I mean, there is a strain hardening about 25% at least more than the yielding. And when we design for what? The yield, right? So we have some more safety coming from the strain hardening of steel. Okay, that's safety also. By the way, in seismic design, they consider that in the design. They consider because they know that the steel will go into the plastic deformation, so it will harden. So you tension this way, then you go the other way, the steel is hardened already. Go ahead.
But to do strain hardening, don't we have to apply the load, release the load, apply the load, release
the load? Yeah, but now if a member is about to fail, right? You need to push that member for a strain beyond 1005 if it's ductile member, right? Once you reach that 1005 or more, you already went into that. Our idealized goes like that, elastoplastic, but the real one is gonna go into that. Yeah, that's why I told you in the seismic design, they consider strain hardening in, sometimes in the seismic design, somehow, the phi factor is equal one, the strength reduction factor. They're saying, you know, we know there is strain hardening. It's not 0.9. We know that, okay? Okay, so strain hardening is something important. You should know it. Someone is telling you what strain hardening, tell him that. You know, when these ductile member, if they are pushed all the way to the limit, they already hardened. They already experience higher strength, okay? In steel design, the guys who did, you remember, we designed for ultimate or yielding or rupture at the connection for tension members and yielding with the member around the cross-section. We covered that. That was a good concept also. Anyway, let me go now. So this theory that we're going to use, we're going to assume the load on the slab is going to be carried in one direction. You can come and say, you know what, if it's two-way slab, I don't care. I want all the load to be carried in short direction. It means you want dm, d square of the moment x over dx square equal w. You want to also ignore any effect or any help coming from the y direction. Is that valid? That's true. Given that, that can be done, by the way, that's expensive. Given that, enough reinforcement is provided to carry this moment. So I can come, there is the loading, right? This is a two-way slab. By the way, this is a two-way slab. If there is no beams, remember the support of the slab is the edge beams. The support of the slab is the edge beam. If there is only edge beams on the four sides in this row, okay, as you can see, this is like a square, or the ratio is less than two, way less than two. So we can say all of this loading, whatever calculate the load, the dead load plus the live load, I want to assume it's going to be carried in this direction. So your strips in this directions must be designed for that loading. So the moment in each strip must be calculated based on W. Paul may come and say, no, I'm going to carry 50% of W in this direction, 50% of W in this direction. This method is flexible with that. Given that you're going to provide enough reinforcement for that 0.5 W and that 0.5 W. In other words, the moment you calculate from 0.5 W, you're going to provide enough reinforcement for it. So that's why it's not wise to assume it in one direction. Why? You're going to say, I don't want to put reinforcement in the other direction. I don't care. You have to put reinforcement in the other direction for shrinkage and temperature. And as we have experienced now, as you know, usually the reinforcement that you need in slabs is very close to the shrinkage and temperature reinforcement. You notice that, right? You know why? Why? In one way, step. The moment is time, not only that, the moment is small, not only that. Why? Why the reinforcement is very close to the minimum shrinkage and temperature, which is 0.0018 times A gross, or BH. How we design the slabs? How we design them? What's the first step in slab design? To design a slab, you need to know what's the self weight of that slab. So the first step is finding the thickness. How did we find the thickness of the slab? From a table in the code, so that if we pick that thickness or something more, deflection or serviceability doesn't have to be checked. Right? So that thickness, guys, was big. That thickness was big. You know, if you pick that thickness usually for the beams, the reinforcement in the beam will become small. So the thickness already good enough, okay, will result in small steel. It doesn't mean that you cannot use smaller thickness. You can use smaller thickness than that in that table, but you have to check flexion. And the reinforcement will need to be higher. You know, design is a balance between the cross-section and the steel. Okay, so let's see how, this is a summary about this method. So this guy in 1956, Hiller Borg, he came up with this method and he had some condition and he said this is a good method providing safe design is about assuming a moment field or assuming a distribution of the loading. And we came up with some ways how we distribute the load in order to have those strips analyzed and designed. Once you distribute the load or you assume the distribution of the load, after that is about structural analysis. And to design that is exactly what we did in one-way design. The thickness is calculated differently. There's an equation how we calculate the thickness of two-way slabs. Two-way slabs. It's not that table. That table is for one-way slabs, if you remember. Okay, there is another table provided by the ACI code, is to calculate the minimum thickness of two-way slabs such that serviceability doesn't have to be checked. We will have it in the example at the end of this handout. I don't think your book or your version of the book can have this strips method for slabs. In the previous one and some other books, I have it, but that's why I sent you this handout, so you have them in your notes. Okay? So I mentioned all of these things. Again, this is the resistant, partial square mx, partial square by partial x square, my, y square. This is the twisting resistant. Must be equal to the load. Must be equal to the load. Okay? Because this is what? This is the load. This is the load resisting that. Second derivative of the moment with respect to x squared is the load. So he's saying in this paragraph here, we're going to ignore the twisting resistance, although it's there, so it's bonus or a safety net for us. So we're going to have this thing. So again, now you're going to say it's a balance. You're going to say, I'm going to have this guy take care of k of this w, a factor. K is a factor from 0 to 1. So this moment, I wanted to resist k of w. This guy's in charge would be in charge of what? 1 minus k. So you will have d squared mx over dx squared equal minus kw, partial square mx my over partial y squared equal that. In other words, the moment in the x direction will be calculated based on kw, the moment in the y direction will be calculated based on the 1 minus w, 1 minus k times w, the remaining. Okay? So again, called lower bound theory, provide safe design. Some examples. You can come and assume this. This is a square slab, right? A square slab. You can come and say half of the load is will be carried in these strips, and half of the load will be carried in this strip. You know, we're talking about, you know, this, there is a W here, guys. Look, there is a W here, a W here, a W here, a W here, a W. Every foot square, there is a W. We know that. So this strip, in this way, if you assume this way, this strip here will carry the same strip here as this, the same as this, the same as this, the same as this. So you design one strip for 1 foot strip, and that reinforcement that you calculate will be for that side. Likewise in here. So those strips will have, if this is square, the length is a, so this is, this strip will be analyzed as follows. W over 2 over a length of a. And this, if this is that is simply supported. If this is simply supported, the moment here will be WL square over 8, but your W is W over 2. So it's WL square over 16, and your L is A. Good? And usually the thickness of the slab, sorry, the span of the slab is taken from where to where? The edge of the beam to the edge of the beam. The edge of the beam to the edge of the beam. Okay? The slab is the flange in the beam. Is the flange in the beam. So the slab usually is that A or whatever you calculate in the moment, and for that deflection calculation, okay, for how much the supposed thickness, is the clear span of the slab. Remember, the width of the beam usually, guys, is not a big deal. I mean, 12 inch or something. Even if you consider to the center, you'll be a little bit conservative, which is fine. But if there is a problem that you are limited with that thickness, you know the thickness is determined, the thickness of the slab based on the clear length of the clear span of the slab, okay? So you can assume that, but if you read here, you say this is conservative. Not only that, remember, those strips here in this direction, they will intersect on the strips in this direction. Those are highly stressed, the strips in the middle here will be highly stressed. That core thing, the middle area, will experience the most, this maximum moment here occur in the middle, right? In the middle in this direction and in this direction. To have that thing, that will require high redistribution of stresses. Remember, when I say redistribution of stresses, it means the steel will reach Fy. When I say redistribution of stresses, it means the steel will reach Fy. Please understand this. By the way, when steel reaches Fy, what does it mean? All of you should know this. When steel in any flexural member reaches Fy, what does it mean? This cracking. Even, you remember, crack even will happen way below that. Remember, I'm cracking how small compared to the I'm altered. But when you say yielding, it means there is some major cracks now. More yielding, it means, look, you should understand this. More yielding, it means you are tensioning the member, the steel bars more. As you tension the steel, stretch the bar more, the crack will open more. You understand this, right? So when I say redistribution and you want to allow for high redistribution, these cracks may become major cracks and annoying and considered unserviceable. So this distribution is not a good distribution, because we know the moment here is big, yes, within this area here, but on the sides, not really. Those strips on the side will not experience the same thing in here. You know why, right? You know why? Okay, look, this area here, this region here, how much movement does it have in this direction? All of this guy, right? All of this guy, right? In that direction, all of this guy. Now, come to this here. How much does it have in this direction? This guy. How much does it have in this direction? This guy. So in the middle, this and this. On the sides, this and very small value. So you see, it's not practical to use this for all the strips. So there is something, you can try something else. Remember, this is what this guy is recommending. And that's not the recommended. You may say, okay, that's how it's going to behave. That's the actual thing, right? You know this from structural analysis, right? And you know these are 45 degrees here. That's how we distributed the load in two-way slab. We just draw 45 degrees from the short side, and the remaining is trapezoid, right? You can come and say, oh, this strip here in the middle, it will take the full load. That's true. This strip, exactly, the one in the center, it will take the full load. So all of this load is carried here. So that's full W. And this guy here is also full W, but that's not realistic. You will have something like that, right there in the center. But that's just at one point. And as we said, the slab has the redistribution capability. So it will take help from the neighbors. So some guys then they come and say, okay, let's do like a step by step, divide by region. The guy who proposed this method, he say this become, the solution become not applicable, provide unsafe design according to this lower bound theory. However, he says, however, with the redistribution capability and the strain hardening of the steel, those will balance this approximation if you do that. With the redistribution capability of the slab, the strain hardening of the steel, they will balance if the average is taken here. If the average is taken, but don't take the average over the length, the average moment over the full length. Try to divide it into segments. Like a segment here, 1/3 with this average, this plus this over 2, a segment here with this plus something like that. But also, this is not the recommended distribution. This is how we recommend dividing a square slab with this strip method for a slab. This is recommended, and this provides the most economical and safe design. Okay? You come, you take those corners here. All those two lines, this line, this line, this line, this line. That's A over 4. Remember, it's a square, so the side is A. So you take a quarter of the A and you draw lines on the four sides. Okay? The corner lines, which is A over 4, A over 4, the load will be carried, this W here, in this square, the small square, and this square, and this square, and this square, 50-50. Okay? And this guy here, the remaining here, we assume the load is going to be carried in this direction. All of it, nothing in this segment. And in this one here, all is in this direction, and nothing is in this direction. This remaining here, which this remaining square in the middle, which is A minus A over 2, over 4, minus A over 4, which is A over 2. This is A over 2. Half-half. I'll tell you what. Now look, this is something straightforward. How many strips we have? How many strips you need to design? You're going to call it the following. This is the X direction, right? And that's the Y direction. If you want to name this is the Y and that's the X, name this M and that's L. No, but we have two directions, right? It's a plane element. Now, what do we have in the X direction? How many strips we have? If we do this, actually two. Edge strip, similar to this, and middle strip. It's easy like that. Where's the third one?
What? One, two, three.
The third has this. This is identical to this.
Okay.
You understand? So in each direction with the square, I have edge strip and middle strip. As follows. So look at this. So that's the strip. What's the length of the strip? I'm talking about square. If you assume simply supported, the overall span is A. What is the overall? This is X direction, and this one is edge strip. Edge strip. What's the loading? You guys tell me what's the loading. What is it? You know what I'm talking about? I'm talking about the strip in this direction. Look how easy. How much this length from here to here? A over 4, right? So you say over A over 4, how much the loading?
W over 2.
Well, as you go in here, how much the loading? 0. It's going in that direction. The load is carried by the strip in that direction. A over 2, 0, A over 2. He has the out for you, so you cannot miss it. Right? A over 2, 0, A over 2. Good? Now let's go to the middle one. The middle one. Over A over 4, the length, what's the load? W over 2. The middle half, W. The other?
Wait.
No,
other way around.
W over 2, W. You know what we did here? We tried to decrease the load from the center of the beam so that the moment is smaller. So, anyway, this is that and that. And what's that? Length? A over 4. And what's this? W over 2. Done. After that, it's structural analysis. Once I give you something like that, it is structural analysis to calculate the moment, the maximum moment. Okay? And the design is as the design of one Meissner.
What if you don't have a square?
Let's talk about the square. Let me teach you the square, then I will teach you the rectangle. Yeah, good question. What's the middle strip? It is A. Yeah, this is for a square. Everything here is for a square. What? W. W over 2. W. It's symmetric loading, right? This lift guy will take care of this. This lift guy will take care of this. So you said WA over 2? W over 2?
W over 2 L. Whatever the length of that.
This, which is, I told you, what is
it? A over 4.
So this is WA over 8. Mm-hmm. A over 4 times W over 2, that's WA over 4. Right? Sorry, WA over 8. So when you draw the shear diagram, what do? You go WA over 4, WA over 8, then you decrease to 0, 0, that and that. Now you know this is an area of constant, a region of constant. A region of zero shear. So how much the moment? Max. So the moment will be max within that half, equal. The 5WA square over 64, which is nothing but taking the cut at A over 2. You want me to do it? So we agreed, how much is this? WA over 8, and what's that? W over 2. And what's this length here? A over 4. And I want this guy, right? So I'm equal WA over 8 times the length from here to here times so square over 32 minus this thing here, which is W over 2 times this, that's the resultant. A over 4 times the distance from here to here. So So the resultant is W over 2 times A over 4, and the distance from here to here is A over 8, or half this. So times A over 8. That's what you have. So you have W A squared over 32 minus W A squared. How much do you have in here? 2, 4, that 64? 64, you do that. This is what? 2?
1 W A squared minus 64.
Why you have that 5? Oh, we have that. For this guy here, to calculate the reaction, let me do that. Someone calculate this for me fast, in no time now, I'll give him one bonus point. That 5 W A squared over 64. You tell me how to do it fast.
Well, we know it's symmetrical, so half the load goes to each reaction. Okay, find the sum of the total reaction.
That's not fast.
That's not bad.
I'll tell you, look at the A over 2, W over 2, right? Make it continuous all the way. That's a similarly supported beam with WA, with W over 2. So that's W L square over 8, W A square over 8, and your W is W over 2, so that's W A square over 16. This guy by itself all the way here is W A square over 16, right? Those guys, you just did them. Those remaining pieces is identical to this, which is going to give you W A squared over 64. So W A squared over 64 plus W A squared over 16 give you that, which is 4 here and 1 here, that's 5. So that's called structural analysis. Okay? An eye of a structural engineer. This is how you see things. You don't have to go to all of these equations, that and that. Most of our structures are asymmetric, symmetric, or can be idealized to be symmetric. You should just figure it out. You did some calculation here, use it. You don't have to do it again in here and make mistakes. Right, Vince? Okay, so this is structural analysis. By the way, is there a minimum area of steel now? Once you calculate the moment here, by the way, and you already, the first thing you do is going to calculate the thickness. So you need to pick steel now. So, right? So you need to design for the area of steel or find rho. Is there a minimum? Shrinkage and temperature, 4 steps, for one way step. 10018 times A gross. That's for grade 60 steel, and for other grades we have them. Okay? But the minimum for one way step is also the minimum here. That's how you check it. Okay, guys? We have 2 strips. By the way, how about the y direction for square stars? How about the y direction? Identical. Same as the x direction. Mm-hmm. You have an edge and you have a middle. So in square slabs, how many strips you need to analyze? 2. The reinforcement you calculate for this strip is from within this region. Stops here, the spacing, because you remember slab, how we design slab, we say number 4 at 10 inch or 8 inch or 12 inch, something like that. In here, you calculate the spacing based on this moment. So the spacing will be high here, then smaller spacing, then high here. Likewise in that direction. 2 layers. The steel in the second direction serve as the shrinkage and temperature for one direction and vice versa. Both directions they should have steel more than the shrinkage and temperature. Good? What if it was rectangular? That's your question. That's what you have. So we, in the terminology we're going to use here, remember this is structural analysis, right? This is how we come here. 45 degree here. We draw this, 45 degree. So these strip segments, the loading, will go in this direction within this, and in this direction within those. Okay? So this is how we're going to distribute this one. We're going to consider that in the terms, in the calculation of the moments here, and for your reference, the long side is A. The short side is B. Okay? So they're saying we're going to take quarter of the short side, so B over 4. Here, this is the distribution. B over 4. Guys, you know this, how much this length here, right? Up to this tip here. How much is this?
B over
2. So you know, so this is B over 2, right? I said this is 45 degree from here to here. If it's 45 degree, how much this one then? B over 2. Okay, but forget, this is the actual behavior. We can assume this field here and revise. So you see guys, for me to understand this thing is more important than doing the design. So strip methods. You assume a distribution of the load, which means you are assuming a moment field. When I say loading, it means moment. Given that a suitable or adequate reinforcement is provided to carry that distribution of that assumed distribution. That's the strip method for slab. The good thing about it, if you have an opening somewhere in the slab, around that opening, you can have different strips. The strips right at the opening, you can make them stronger with more reinforcement so that they relieve whatever coming on that opening. That's the good thing about it. So those strips around the opening, you can have, basically, you know what's a strip method, guys? It's about beams, strips, those that act like beams. As I told you, slabs, they are beams with 1 foot width. Okay? Beams with 1 foot or 1 meter strips or width. So this is what we're gonna use, but this one, be careful. Be careful now. We're gonna have 4 strips for a rectangular slab. 4 strips. Now, you come, you take B over 4. As I said, B is the short direction. See, this is B over 4, and this is how much? B over 4. So B over those corners, the dimension of those are B over 4 times B over 4. Good? So this remaining here equal what? Look at this remaining is B over 2. This remaining, Josh, is B over 2. What's this remaining?
A minus B over 2.
You have to be careful. It is? No, he's right. It's A minus B over 2.
Okay.
That's the mistake what the students make. For some reason, they have A minus A over 2. That corner is the short dimension divided by 4, which is a quarter of the short direction on both sides. So on the side of the short direction, you have the remaining B over 2 in the middle. So you have B over 4, B over 2, B over 4. In the long direction, you will have B over 4, A minus B over 2, B over 4. So in the X direction, you will have 2 strips now, 1 edge, 1 middle. And in the y direction, we'll have 2 strips, edge and middle. Okay? Now, this is the assumption. Again, in those corners here, we're going to assume 50-50 for the load. W over 2, W over 2. And this guy here, we're going to assume everything is carried in this direction, along the short direction. Everything is in the long direction. Right? And this here, we're going to assume everything is carried in this direction. Any justification for that? Now, I said, look, safe, it is safe. We make it safe. We, engineers, make it safe by providing enough reinforcement to transfer the load. Now, is it economical? What we did, is it economical? Think, before you answer, think, it's economical. This way, it's economical. Why? Look, in the wrong direction, the long span, how much the loading that we ask that span to carry? Not much. Only W on their sides. Nothing. This long side, A side, is not carrying other than this and that. But the short span is carrying the full load. It means the moment is smaller. Because we know is the moment is W, whatever intensity that side is carrying, times the square of the length, divided by a number. Good? Okay? See, this is short. It's carrying the full load. This, if you give the full load to this long, the moment could be twice. Like, just to give you an example, 20 square maybe you have 20 and 15. So 20 square compared to 15 square. Talking about 400 and 225. With a difference of 15 to 20, the dimension of the slab. Okay? So this way is economical. Say it's safe. You said it's safe because of the many things I mentioned. So now, let me draw for you this. So x direction. So you see, like my writing is like doctors. When you go to the doctor, they give you like a prescription. You have no clue what they're doing there. Assume it's semi-supported. This is x direction edge. By the way, guys, you know, and sometimes in the exam, one of the questions I give in the exam, show me these strips and calculate the moment for me. Don't design, just show me these strips. For those who are not sleeping, I'm not sure if you are hearing. One time I gave a question, show me these strips, distribute the loading for the following dimension, and calculate for me the moment for the edge and middle in the x and y. Don't design. Because I know once you have that, the design is exactly as the design of one-way slab, which a question before that was, design a one-way slab. So Laura's laughing.
No.
So this edge, x direction, we're talking about this guy here, right? What's the length? Talking edge, x, you guys have to tell me now. What's the span length? A. What's the loading now? When I say edge, Andrew, this is my guy. So look, this is how you walk it, guys, by your finger. Over this length, I have W over 2. What's that length? B over 4. So you come here, you say B over 4, he has a W of W over 2. Now you walk from all the way from here to here, nothing. There is no arrow in this direction. It means there's nothing transferred in this direction. Once you hit here, you have that. So that's your strip. So this is W over 2, and this is V over 4. Guys, listen. When you calculate the moment for that, it's not, don't memorize the one that we did for the previous one. That one over there was what? Was there? Was A over 4. Now you have B with an A. You have to be careful. You will have the B instead of the A over there. Most of you will have this one wrong. Over there we had it A, now we have it B. It doesn't just depend on this. It's just, you don't memorize, guys. This is structural analysis. This is structural analysis. Then you calculate the moment as we did. Now how about the middle strip? The length is the same. That's A. Let me walk in the middle. Talking about x direction. A over 2 or A? A. Full A within this. All of it. Nothing is going in this direction. All of it here. Nothing. A. Sorry.
W.
Nothing. W. W, W, and what is this?
B over 4.
So half of this. Half of this. Good? How about the other guy? I'm gonna make one comment before I erase those. So the edge, y direction. Edge. What's the length? B. You have numbers, by the way, in the question, you have numbers. What's the loading? That's my direction. I'm talking about the edge. we say, okay, over B over 4, I have W over 2, nothing W over 2. And this is B over 4, and the remaining is B over 2, and this is B over 4. By the way, this will give you the same moment as the X, but the length is different, but it will give you the same moment. Same moment. Because it just depends on the loading. Just depends on the loading. How about the wrong direction? The middle. Sorry, not the long direction, I'm talking about the middle strip. In the y direction. So it is B and the loading is here. Easy now. This is easier. Just double. This is W. So how much the moment for this guy here? So this and that will have the same design. This will be different than this. So what you will have, guys, this is a simply supported, by the way. If you have fixed condition, it's completely different. Completely different. I'm going to tell you in a minute, and we're going to consider stop that or solve that next lecture. But look, now you have these numbers, right? You have the numbers. So how do you start for? If you have these numbers, you did the analysis perfectly, what do you do?
Find the worst case scenario.
So where do you start with design? That's very smart. No. He will start with WB squared over 8. Because you know what? You know why? That may be even less than the minimum reinforcement. If this requires reinforcement less than the shrinkage and temperature reinforcement, you're done. Any moment that's less, and all of them are less, so you say shrinkage and temperature both direction, done. If that requires reinforcement, you design the reinforcement. Then you know the region. Where do you go next? To this guy. Okay? Is bigger than this twice. This, if this require something less than the shrinkage and temperature, you use the shrinkage and temperature for this and for the remaining strip. So you always design with the maximum or the worst case scenario, as I said. If that less than the minimum, you use the minimum. So by the way, which one you put on top? There's two layers, right? Steel. There is one in the x, there's one in this direction, and there's one in this direction, right? Which one you put at the bottom, if it's simply supported? The one who had a bigger moment, so it gives you higher D. So look, if you design, this one for WB squared over 8, assume D equal H minus 1, which we use, remember we said the covers, usually we take it to the center of the bar in this, as 1 inch. If it's more than a little bit more than 1 inch, that's fine, take it. But when you wanna require to design, I mean the shrinkage and temperature is not controlling. For this one, D for this guy, which is in the other direction, is smaller than D there, because it's gonna be on the top of it. So the D will be half bar and half bar. It's 1 bar difference. You have to be careful. We're gonna say what D has to do with the thing. And what we are doing at the end, what, you know what we are doing? These are unultimates, right? These are unultimates. You know what we are going to use? Unultimate equal phi r b d squared. Just to remind you, r is determined from where? No, not r, forget r. We have b d. We have b d for slabs. The only thing we need to come up with is just r. Once we have r, we go to the table, we get rho. We check that rho with shrinkage and temperature, not the row with the shrinkage and temperature, that the AST. The AST, because remember, the shrinkage and temperature row is multiplied by a gross. That row from structural analysis or from strength analysis is multiplied by BD. So you compare AS with A shrinkage and AS shrinkage and temperature. Anyway, you know this, and I stated this clear in the previous lectures about slab. But when you want to analyze this one here, this I'm ultimately, let's assume they are high. It's going to be phi 0.9 r b d squared. This d here is d that you use in the other direction minus, usually, I don't want to say 1 inch, at least 1/2 inch. Let's say we're assuming number 4. If we use number 4, but usually we, in the slabs, guys, we use number 4 or number 5. Unless the slab is really major slab, like a slab bridge or something, you may go with high bars. The bridge is slab, not slab with a beam. The whole bridge could be a slab. It's called a slab bridge. Okay, but for typical slabs, as you know, it's 5 inch, 6 inch thickness, 4 inch thickness, something like that, depending on the spacing between the floor beams. So if you have, and usually as we said, as you saw in the exam that I solved, and in the, if you read the exam is in the book, number 4, number 5, number 3 sometimes, right? So if you say number 4, so you, that the bottom one will be number 4, right? And D there calculated H minus the cover to the center of that bar. The second layer here will have half number 4 and half number 4, just 1/2 inch. So expect D at least to be, or you can assume, 1/2 inch less than that. Remember the table I showed you in the design aids? By the way, there's a table based on whatever D they give you, what's PMN. For slab designs, that table. That's fine. It's in every book. It's different than the guy we use.
I've got some new book if you want.
Here's just want to show the design aids.
Here.
Yeah, that table, as I told you, once you have an ultimate, David A9 says, design strength phi mn for slabs sections 12 inch wide in foot cable. Okay, this is what does it say. So this they give you for F prime C, whatever F prime C, you can see this. F prime C, let's say 4000 PSI. Whatever thickness or effective depth D you have in here, these numbers here are phi mn. So you pick, and once you have phi mn here, greater than what ultimate you calculated, you go here to get rho, this rho. This is rho. Then you calculate, you multiply this rho times BD, and that area of steel is compared with area for shrinkage and temperature. Okay? So that table gives you this directly if you want to use it. Okay, guys. Now, one more thing before I'm going to use this next time. How much time we have?
4 minutes.
Okay. Now, look, this is, I don't want to call it inappropriate, but this method can, by the way, if you have a negative or positive moment, you still can assume a ratio between them. See, this is, there's the total moment, something called cantilever moment. That if we assume this side is a cantilever, it means this end here is in charge of carrying this moment. If I know what's this distance and this loading, what's, and this is a cantilever, how much the moment here? If this one was W, it's W times the length squared over 2 for a cantilever, right? A cantilever beam. We say this cantilever will be negative and positive. This method can assume sometimes the positive is 1/3 of that moment and the negative is 2/3 of that moment. It can go there. But with the new technology, with what I taught you in structure analysis, you can analyze it. You don't have to assume this. Can you go and analyze this one and find the exact moments here? Yes, you can, easily. But the method also extends. Why the method is also valid if you want to assume these moment fields? I'm going to show you. I'm going to explain it here. So you can assume, you see, you distribute the moments. You can distribute the moments. When I go over the exam next time, we're going to calculate something called cantilever beam. That's the total moment. The total moment. That moment is carried or developed or divided into negative or positive. Okay, for a simply supported beam, guys. For a simply supported beam. How much the moment? Let's see if you know this one or not. For a simply supported beam with length L, with W, what's the maximum moment? So the moment will look like this, right? WL squared over A, and this is positive here. Some guys, they draw it on the bottom side. Okay, we know this one. So that's the moment, right? Right? Because it was simply supported. What if I fix it? What if I fix this, those supports? With the same loading, with the same help. When I fix it, you know what I'm doing? I'm asking the fixed support to share or carrying this moment. Usually, you should know how much the moment carry. How much? I'm gonna throw myself from there. If the maximum foot in here was over 8, this must be less. This number you should not forget it, guys. So this is WL squared over 12. Now look, look what's happening. You know how much is this? The remaining here? You know what I said? Look at this rope. This moment is a rope. This moment is a rope. When you fixed it, the same shape is brought down. So the distance, this full, this thing here, still WL squared over 8. So this tiny piece is WL squared over 8 minus WL squared over 12. So that's WL squared over 24, if you do this division. So the moment, guys, the moment diagram, it's like a rope, you carry it. If this is the only one that's fixed, you just take this one and you pull it down. And if you know one of them, you should know the other. Okay? Either you pull it from both sides or you pull it in one side, if you fix one side only. Okay? This is, they say this is, but again, no, you don't have to do it. You have the software, I'm teaching you, you're designing a full structure in ETAS. Whenever you have something like that, you just go and do it, analyze it, find the moments, then design for them. The distribution will be assumed the same. Distribution will be the same, see? It's gonna be W over 2 in both directions, full W here, full W here, full W here. So you have edge strip, middle strip, edge strip, middle strip. Once you have them, you have the software, go analyze them. Don't assume a moment field again, not the moment field here. Now, assume a relationship between the negative and positive. If the condition is not pen, if it's pen, you don't have to assume anything, it's determinate. The only reason we are assuming now, because it's indeterminate. But we know how to solve indeterminate structures, right? Easy. Or do it. So next time, go over this one, please, before you come. So I can go over it fast. And hopefully, if we have time, or we finish this, and we go over, we review design of one-way slab again. We have so many examples, and I need to show you something called moment coefficients. Moment coefficients. With that, I'll see you next time.
Not
yeah.
I mean, I've been around while we've been pouring slabs, and we always use.